Hello. So welcome to this show on Career Conversations. So in this particular episode, I'm having Saurav Bhuwania. So who in many ways is an iconic achiever, a chartered accountant, an MBA from FMS, and now he's cracked the UPSC. So for some reasons, we are having this conversation in the form of an audio podcast rather than a video. So welcome to the show, Saurav. Congratulations for cracking UPSC with All India rank 113 and third in the interviews. So isn't this feeling amazing, right?
Yes, sir. It has been, it has been more than 4 months since I got the results, but I think it is yet to sink in. It was actually a bit of pleasant surprise. Despite my efforts, I thought that if I could manage to make it such high rank, it would be a real surprise. So I think the feeling is yet to sink in, and I'll be going to join my training in next few days. I think once I go there, I would finally be admitted at final target. So I'm still waiting for those days to arrive very early.
So I just caught you in the nick of time for this interview.
Yes, sir. It's 3-4 days to go now. After 4 days, I'll be gone.
All right. So to start off with your career journey, I always start with schooling because I've always believed that schooling plays a very important role. So you did your schooling at Dumka. Right.
Yes.
So what are the pros and cons of a small town education as compared to, as a flashy big town school where you've got host of amenities, etc., a more cosmopolitan crowd? So what was your journey in terms of the schooling? What was your key learnings in terms of value-based education, your upbringing, etc.?
Sir, till class 10th, I was in Dumka only. It was only after class 10th, I moved to Kolkata for my commerce education. And living in Dumka, if I recollect my memories, I believe that had its share of pros and cons. So I would like to first talk about the difficulties and challenges which a small town education brings in front of you. So the first one is there is some sort of underconfidence which the likes of us have. You might come across many people who have come from small towns who lack confidence a bit, which they eventually manage with their experience and lifestyle. But initially, there is a sort of underconfidence which creeps in them just because of the fact that they are from a small town. The second one is lack of adequate amenities which a modern education mechanism demands nowadays. So yeah. We see that. In modern era, there is a lot of emphasis on extracurriculars. The school take a proactive role in grooming the child and not just educating the child. Which places like Dumka, Deoghar, no, I won't say Deoghar, Dumka and nearby other small towns, they lack these facilities. So, two are the major issues which I feel are real issues for any small town education. On the brighter side, I got to live with my family. So even at the age of 32, I'm still like too much attached to them, which is not directly correlated with being in a small town. But I think being with family was a major reason that I would hail education from a small town, or for that matter, any hometown, and a very good option. Till class 10th, you are still budding. You feel and you develop a relation with your family members, relatives around, neighbors, which make you a lot more outgoing, and you are not a shy person. For example, one small example I'll tell you. In city, it takes real good strength from within to learn motorcycle at class 7 because we are so protective about everything.
Yes, absolutely.
But that is not the case in small towns. We, the likes of us, I, my friends, we just took our father's bike. I was in class 7 only. And we just learnt it of our own. Our father hardly got bothered about it. There was very less traffic. The kind of bonhomie and the kind of friendship we used to have was a bit less unadulterated, a bit less adulterated. Because the kind of innocence, the kind of upbringing is there in a small town. Because people are a bit less smart, which eventually add spice to your life. I think that one factor becomes very important. And The most important thing which a small town brings to your life is that it makes you street smart. You know how to deal with adversities. You know that you will need to compete with the students who have been brought up in a much better way after you go to cities. So that makes you a lot more accommodating, a lot more adjusting, and street smart. So this factor compensates for many other shortcomings. And I have seen that even though I went to St. Xavier's Kolkata, SMS Delhi, then I joined Reserve Bank of India. So there were adjustments I had to make initially to fit myself into the scenario. But those things have added to my experience and personality. So I think this is a big plus for being if you are from a small town.
Yeah, absolutely. So you came to Calcutta and joined which school in class 11?
The Srijan Vidyalaya, Brabant Road. Okay.
And then you joined St. Xavier's, chose the normal straight jacketed CA path. I mean, that's a very conventional choice for a chartered accountant. You know, joined St. Xavier's Kolkata, and for a commerce student, joined St. Xavier's Kolkata and complete CA. Now in retrospect, what were your thoughts on completing CA and spending that much time in your early years on the chartered accountancy course?
Sir, I believe that CA was my first choice, even consciously and subconsciously. Since I was a commerce student in class 12, getting into St. Xavier's was the lifetime dream, because that was the best college around in Kolkata. And again, small something comes into play here. I was very much eyeing St. Xavier's because I wanted to make my parents proud that their kid has gone to St. Xavier's College. And then after I went there, CA became an automatic choice because almost everybody was doing CA. So I believe doing CA, and once you start CA, you try and complete the course. That's what I did. So it was primarily on autopilot mode till CA. So I don't regret it at all, because even in my MBA days, in RBI days, it helped me big time by just because of the fact that I'm a chartered accountant. Also, I took my optional as commerce only in UPSC. So CA has been my backbone throughout my life. But one thing I would like to point out here is that it was not consciously I chose CA. It was primarily the imitation, the herd mentality, that being a commerce student, I have to go for CA.
Yes,
this cannot be misunderstood with my regret.
Yes. And so then
I'm... Huh? Yes, sir. Yes, you speak, please.
So you completed CA, and so what further, like, did you face any challenges in completion of CA?
So CA was smooth, sir, because I believe I have been decent student throughout my life, and I am more consistent than studious. So I studied all through the time. Even if it's 2, 3, 4 hours, but I keep on studying. So I believe that consistency is key to success in chartered accountancy, in courses like chartered accountancy or company secretary or cost management. So that's what I primarily did with my college. So CA was smooth. I could clear all levels in first attempt just because of the fact that I studied all through the phase, and it was not last 2 months. I did a lot of hard work and focused a lot. Last 2 months were important, but I felt hardly any pressure.
You chose to serve PwC SDC for 2 years. So yes, that was, you know, initial days of PwC SDC also, 2011 would have been the just setting up of PwC SDC. So what was the unique part about that almost two years, your first stint with corporate life? So what was your reflections in retrospect on that?
Sir, there is a lot of dilemma for many aspirants with respect to PwC SDC. They want it for convenience, for the fact that it is in Kolkata, it is in their hometown or nearby. At the same time, I have seen a lot of feedback, a lot of reviews, that the kind of profile which SDC provides is not worth it, and there could be a bit of less progression in future life. So this has to be managed. It cannot be a win-win situation for everybody. Some of my friends have gone to very other organizations just by being in PwC, and it has been individual capability which has to come into play later on in their life. So an organization helps you discover yourself. If I tell about myself, I was not much of a corporate type. Be it PwC, KPMG, Capgemini, or any other corporate I worked with, these are the three organizations which I worked with for a decent amount of time. I have not felt comfortable, but that is primarily because of the fact that I had other aspiration, and not because the corporate life is not up to the mark. There are people who are, including my brother only, who are doing great in their corporate life, but there is one suggestion I would like to make give to the aspirants, that after a certain degree of money, if money is the driving force, I believe that after a certain package, be it 15 lakh for somebody or 18 lakh for somebody else, the money stops being a driving force. So the key lies in continual discovery of yourself. You need to have your hobbies, you need to have your aspirations, separate aspirations apart from work and money. Then you need to have some sort of extracurricular in your life which keeps you moving, which gives you some sort of aim in life. Also, you need to be socially involved, and you need to consider yourself as an important wheel in this whole channel of nation, I would say rather. Because you just cannot keep your thoughts confined to yourself, ki nahi itna package ho gaya to I'm doing good for myself. That will rather add to depression after a certain point of life. So you need to maintain your work-life balance emotionally, physically and psychologically. So that becomes very important in a corporate life. If I have seen people who are earning very very well, but just because of the fact that they don't have any other aspiration or other engagement, they are supremely depressed in their life. So you need to escape that right from the moment you are stepping into it. As a college student, you have some hobbies, you have some extracurricular activities, you need to just carry on with it.
Yes, absolutely. Then FMS came into your life, you know, the 2-year full-time MBA. And FMS, that way is, you know, is good because the fees is so incredibly low. Now they have increased it, but at that point of time, it was indeed India's highest ROI MBA. So then, but you were already married, quitting job for 2 years, you're already settled and earning maybe a double, like 10 lakhs or something like that kind of a salary. And then you quit that and joined studies. So what are the thoughts on that? Because that becomes quite a decision-making dilemma for a lot of people. That once I've become CA, I've started earning 9 lakhs, 10 lakhs. Then to quit it and do a 2-year MBA, either from a low-cost institute like FMS or a 20 lakh cost institution like IIMs. So what is that feeling? I mean, what would be your thoughts on that?
Sir, I believe that once we become chartered accountant at the age of 22 or 25, we have effectively 35 years of career. We need to spend only in working if we want to. So that was, this seems very normal if you actually don't introspect about it. But this will look very frightening if you deeply think about it. So I just wanted to take chances with my life till the time I can take. It was for aspiration. It was for fun. It was for discovery of myself. There were many reasons that I took this plunge. Because for preparation of that, I had even left my job for 2 months. So these risks I knew seem very, very large scale when we see it from a very myopic point of view. But if we see it just from the prism of life as a whole, these risks will look like nothing. Because if I'm preparing for something, if I don't succeed at CAT or any other exam for that matter, I would get something. This is it could be that I might be lagging behind with 1 lakh or 2 lakh, but in the long term, it will not matter much. So just because of 1 lakh or 2 lakh per year, I cannot risk not taking risk. So that was my motto in life, and it has been my motto in life, because I believe till the time we have energy, we are charged up with youth, we can take various choices, we can make mistakes, and then we can be again back on track without bothering about the fact that people are saying, no, you do this, you take the conventional path, because conventional becomes very boring and very frustrating at times. So if you are ready to take some risk, I think life will be a bit better in that sense. And in hindsight, I feel that even though my choices were risky, but I feel they were worth it just because of the fact that I feel very glad about it. And even if I would not have made it, I would not have been married to FMS or RBI or UPSC for that matter, I would have been pretty glad about it because I made my choices. And I was very much adamant about the fact after I became CA that now since I will definitely be good enough for the rest of my life to feed my family so I can take my risk. And I stood by it. And I even today feel that this has to be the lifestyle, and we just cannot keep on bothering about petty issues. Ki 10 lakh ke badle 9 lakh ho jayega. This seems very myopic way of leading a life. So I don't vouch for that. And that was my inspiration, and that was my thought process throughout those 5-7 years.
That's a very powerful thought, Saurav, that the conventional life, eventually, you know, you kind of actually become very frustrated in that conventional life, chasing packages, especially if you have a desire to move into something higher, something better. So I think that way is your choice to move to FMS was quite wonderful. So then what did you learn from B school? Let's say what you didn't learn in CA. That is my first question. And the second question is that on the day of the convocation, so most of us, like once the MBA is complete, we feel that yes, it's, we are done with our education. Had you ever thought that more education now awaits you?
So the first question, I'll take up the first question, sir. In FMS or in any other good B school, what I think in terms of education, like commerce concepts, finance concepts, we are already very good. We have dealt with a lot in all these 4 or 5 years in chartered accountancy, that we are already good enough to work in an organization content-wise. But MBA does something to you, like it makes you more comfortable with deadlines. It gives you certain degree of comfort while working with others. It gives you a peer group wherein you are doing learning from others, which we actually miss in courses like chartered accountancy, which are primarily correspondence course. We don't have any peers studying with us. It's only our choice that we get to gel with one or two persons and then we do combined studies. But it's not something which is forced on you. Again, there are no set of teachers whom you actually can call teachers, because this is a very commercial way of, there is a very commercial way of teaching in chartered accountancy. We pay money, we get our course completed, and then there is no relation with that teacher if we don't want to keep. But in colleges like FMS, IIM or SPJN, you develop a certain degree of affinity, a certain degree of affiliation with that college. You become an alumni of that particular college. So there are a lot of factors which come into play if you belong to a certain batch of a certain college. That affiliation is missing in chartered accountancy because there is no batch. We start together, but we don't end up together. So there is no batch affiliation. It's just ICAI, which we know that we are a part of that ICAI. That is again a very good association, but that does not create that emotional association with a particular set of people, because all ICAI members are ICAI members. So MBA gives you some recognition in terms of students, in terms of, and that extrovertism helps you in your career later on. So CA plus MBA, according to me, is a very good combination if somebody wants to succeed in life. But normally what we creep that content-wise to kuch alag se nahi sikha. That was not even the motto. We had to be a bit of extrovert. If we are not, then we need to gel with our friends. We need to work on timelines. We need to work on deadlines and be ready for the corporate job in the best possible way we can. So MBA basically is a pseudo preparation of corporate life, which helps you in later part of your life.
Okay, got it. And actually, so you're still in touch with your batchmates of FMS? Let's say
we have a group. We have, that's what I'm saying to you, that if any chartered accountant drops a message regarding, until unless he's a very close friend, we don't even pay heed to it. This is not generalizing of me. This is normally what happens.
But in FMS,
there is a batch affiliation. If somebody from your batch has told you, has recommended you or asking for recommendation, people actually do their best. So that sense of affinity, that sense of belongingness is still there. And we feel very connected. So we are in some of us. So our batch size was 220. So normally I could make friends with 20 of them. Normally that is what one can do. So I am in regular touch with each of them.
Oh, fantastic. Okay. And the second part of my question, and it's more interesting, that on the day of the convocation, did you have some inkling that more education awaits you, RBI will train you, and the UPSC is subsequently going to train you, you have to crack more entrance exams?
I have this bone in myself, which I always feel that I will not be satisfied, because education is something which has become an important part of my life, because everything I have got in my life is because of education. All these bit of recognition and acceptance is because of education. After hailing from a small town, I think if I could make a mark, it's because of education. So even though I could clear FMS, I could pass out from there, I was landing in a corporate job. I had made my mind that if not, I was not sure what I will study for or what would be the course I'll be doing. But I had this liking for studying more, beat anything. So luckily, when I got in Reserve Bank of India, they had their training for 3.5 months, 100 days, which was a very good experience. Even at that point of time, I was not very much sure that I will be doing UPSC. It came in my life and I did it. So primarily, the fact is that I have left my life on as and when it comes basis. Whatever happens, I just keep on being with it in the moment. And that is really helping big time. I think this sounds very easy, but this becomes very tough when you actually try to implement it, to just let go and be with the moment. But now since I've been trying it for many years, I feel that I can achieve a lot of it. So that study wala thing, I think I cannot even say even now whether I'm done with it. It could be something else in further. So one more thing I would like to add, that if you keep on studying, that keeps the youth within you alive. And this is my personal experience, and I can vouch for that, that if you are studying, if you are keeping on studying something or other, that student within you will keep you young forever.
Oh, this is so wonderful. I mean, these lines can be things which I can remember for a lifetime. But I think, you know, one of the reasons why one can also take a lot of these unconventional choices, and I can relate, because after 5.5 years of corporate life, I had also taken a plunge for my 1 year MBA at IMA.
Yes,
that you need very supportive family ecosystem, because you know the world will say 100 things ki pagal ho gaya hai kya kama raha hai acha kaasa kya isko bhi achanak fitur chad gaya. But then when your wife, your parents, they all support you, you get that strength ki chalo risk leke chalte hain, right?
Yes, sir. In this matter, I've been pretty lucky. So despite being the fact that my parents were from small town, they had this conventional thought process. They never, and also there could be some issues which might be financial, because I cannot keep asking for money from them for the rest of my life. So there was certain risk, but they never said no. They told ki chalo karo, we will see whatever happens will happen. And I know ki now since other ek wo sense of security which comes with being a chartered accountant, I took that for granted. Kuch nahi to, I will at least teach somebody aur ghar chal jayega. And so the moment you and your family members think alike in the fact that ki basic minimum jo hai, at least wo to manage ho jayega, so that gives you immense strength. So that was, again, I told you, it was not my personal motto. It was the motto of my wife, my mother, my father. Everybody was on the same line. Ki CA ban gaya hai, to bhuke nahi marenge. And the moment that confidence creeps in, uske baad, don't seem like a risk. These are the dilemma which we create just because our minds are very calculative and we just keep on pondering what if not. If we just see the positive side of it, that you are already a chartered accountant or a company secretary or cost management accounting, you can have this luxury to risk your life for 1 to 2 years. That is not a big deal. And if you take calculative risk, I think that is not a risk at all. You can just find some or other way out in your life. So that is what I did, and my family has been super supportive with all my choices.
So that's very key takeaway for us, that one, if you are a chartered accountant, ban gaye to kabhi bhuke nahi marenge. So this is one powerful thing about our course.
Sir, ye bolte sab hum log. Everybody, each of us speaks this, but we hardly any of one believes this. Wo ekdam wholeheartedly believe karna padega. CA ban gaye, padha ke, audit karke, practice karke, job karke, we will earn something, achha khasa account, decent life ji lenge. We have to believe this. Hum log sir bol ke chhod dete hain.
Yes, absolutely. And then, you know, your 1 year stint at Capgemini, I think post FMS, it finally told you that corporate world is not your calling.
Yes, sir.
So,
sir,
how was that thing? Again, you have to go back to the boardroom and convince people ki bhai ab corporate job nahi karna hai. RBI ka exam crack kiya, ab RBI join karna hai. And maybe the salary at RBI would have been less than that of Capgemini.
Yes, sir. It was not much of a difference, but it would become a gulf in the later part of years, because corporate mein, if we keep on slogging, our pay rise would be very steep as compared to RBI, jahan pe there is a conventional increment year by year. So it was not that big a gulf initially, but it would definitely become a big gap after 5 years or 7 years. But that was the last dilemma in my life, to whether be or to take another chance for Reserve Bank or another change in my life. But I evaluated all the pros and cons, and that concept again came into play. कि आफ्टर अ सर्टन डिग्री ऑफ मनी इट कुड बी डिफरेंट फॉर डिफरेंट पीपल बट फॉर मी आई कुड मैनेज आई कुड मेक इट टू 14 टू 15 लैक्स दैट आफ्टर दिस मच ऑफ मनी ऑल आई डू इज टू सेटिस्फाई माई ईगो इट इज नेवर अबाउट अ लाइफ स्टाइल इट इज नेवर अबाउट लीडिंग अ पीसफुल लाइफ इट इज जस्ट अबाउट सेटिस्फाइंग माई ईगो कि इतना कमा रहे हैं आई विल हैव one property here, two property here, it will just become an endless ego trip. So that is where I introspected a lot and thought that if I am with Reserve Bank, I will get a decent lifestyle, a decent salary, and also I would be in an organization which will give me the peace of mind and I will have a definite lifestyle, which I might not have in any corporate organization. So I firmly thought about it, consulted my parents and were onboarded. And they were very much in support with the idea, and then I took the change. So it is just about, if it is just about the money, the corporate life will not suit you. You have to be passionate about your job, then corporate life is perfect. But money cannot be the sole driving force.
Correct. Now, Saurav, when you look back at life, because UPSC happened, and we were discussing this the other day. UPSC also happened because you went to RBI and there were a lot of aspirants, ex-UPSC aspirants whom you met who kindled that desire. So your inspiration, as you said, was kind of borrowed inspiration also. So that would have been quite wonderful, right?
Sir, initially it was borrowed. So till the time it was borrowed, it was a burden. What I could feel that I saw many people preparing for UPSC. Even I tried doing that. So till the time it was an emulation, I felt that studying was a big task. I am not getting into it. But after two, three months, I into the preparation mode. I could feel the potential of an UPSC candidate. Even a candidate, you don't need to clear the exam to make some change. Even the thought process I used to have, it changed for good after I started preparing for UPSC. I became a lot more grounded with my thought process. I could see the ground realities. I could relate to those issues. My upbringing from a small town came with all the pictures and scenarios came vividly in front of my eyes. So these things really made me a complete UPSC aspirant. So after 2-3 months, although it was very tough in terms of managing time, family and office, but I was enjoying the process entirely. So my preparation journey was for approximately 2 years. But these 2 years, despite being hectic, were the most wonderful years of my life.
So if I were to practically ask, you know, because your prime time during the day, you have to study, you have to be at RBI. So do you wake up early in the morning, you have to study late in the night, or weekends, you don't go out, you just study? How does one manage so much study with a job? That is one big dilemma for people.
Sir, initially I became very rigid that I have to study from 8 p.m. to 12 p.m. every day and night. But at times I felt that you are not in the real mindset or you have some other commitment. It could be my kids' vaccination or some other ailments, or it could be some functions or ceremony. So after frustration of initial 3-4 months, I could conclude that I have to be super flexible. If I am not able to study in the night as per my timetable, I have to wake up early. I have to make up for it. Even in buses or traveling in metro or cab, I tried to make the most. Now, since there are so much videos available online, I could make most of my, I could really use my travel time or any other time based in studying only. Even in office, I reduced my lunch hours or tea times and used them effectively in preparation, because with UPSC preparation, you are never done. You feel that you are not even adequately prepared, even though you prepare for two years sitting at home. So that feeling never came that I am ready for UPSC. All I could manage to do was to keep trying and ensure that I am preparing the best I can prepare. So that was, again, that was the phase where I left any hope or any dream of getting my name into the list. All I was doing was to be with the process, because that was the only thing I could afford. If I keep on pondering about result kya hoga, it would be very frightening, because people are preparing daily with adequate coaching and studying 16 hours a day, while I'm here with only 4 to 5 hours at my disposal. So I just focused on doing my best and ensuring that I could have optimum time.
So you kind of followed the Karmanne Vadikaraste Ma Phalesu Kadachana philosophy.
Yes, if we reduce it to one shloka, that was completely it. And even on weekends, I was not much bothered. I studied for 8 hours or 7 hours, and rest of the time I could play with my kid. I would be out somewhere with my friends, or I was not completely shut from the world. So I did my best in the best possible way, and did not even bother about what could be the consequences. So that shloka really makes sense.
Wow, that's nice. So you didn't take coaching, much of coaching. I think I read your interview somewhere. You had just gone for some mock interviews in Salt Lake. And normally one tends to believe ki bhai IAS matlab to naukri chhod ke sab kuch chhod ke Delhi chale jao, in that particular township of Delhi where everyone is a UPSC aspirant. Then self-study, I kind of, I'm very confused in that ways. We self-study or going to Delhi and being a part of that factory, what really works in your view now?
Sir, but if I tell you, had I been 23 or 22, and I would have been given some encouragement, even I would have been part of the factory. So because the thing is that if you could afford it with respect to time, money and everything else, you don't have any obligation. I think coaching is actually a solution, because that keeps you engaged, and there is a possibility that you will not be wavered. At the same time, I would also say that if somebody has constraints like me, if somebody is married or does not have financial backup, nowadays self-study can also be an alternative for preparing for any exam, including UPSC. With UPSC, the challenge actually is to have sorted ideas about what to read and what not to read. We have such voluminous data information on internet with respect to UPSC that it's very easy to confuse and lose one's way. So what I did was to focus only on the basic books and concepts and read the syllabus of UPSC in a very dedicated way and ensure that whatever I am reading or studying directly correlates with the syllabus. I solved a lot of mock papers which are available online with respect to prelims examination, mains examination. So there was a very simple process I followed with very simple books and simple preparation mode. There was no rocket science in my preparation, and that is the way I believe that one should go for UPSC, even though he is living in Delhi with coaching, or he is not, or he is working somewhere, or is not able to go to Delhi. Whoever he or she is, there has to be a very simple process without bothering. We just tend to fall prey to a lot of books, a lot of notes, which does not come handy at the time of revision. So we need to keep our books sorted, our preparation strategy, and be consistent. So sir, for this 2 years almost, I was very consistent that I could manage to study on almost all days. Even though I felt a bit low or there is some contingency, I could make it up by waking early or by being awake at night. But I had to ensure that I am doing that daily quota. So that was my lifestyle for 2 years. And eventually at the end of it, it becomes your success.
All right. One question that comes to my mind is that, UPSC. So I know some students of mine who after CA quit their good corporate jobs, let's say went to Delhi because they were young, as you said, 24, 25, and didn't crack UPSC for 2 attempts, and they've been completely shattered. So then, that risk, how does one cope with? Yes, of course, you can always return back to that corporate life with a twist here and there. But, for a weak-hearted person like me, this can become a big, that specter of not clearing even after 2 attempts, 3 attempts, because UPSC has that thing. No one really, I think, clears it in the first attempt. You need at least 2 attempts, 3 attempts to crack it. So what are your thoughts on that high risk, high return kind of a philosophy in a UPSC exam?
Sir, I think after 1 attempt, you have done with, after having left your job, you have spent 1 year in Delhi. I think that is good enough time to make you ready content-wise for the exam. You are ready for the exam content-wise. You are ready with enough material in your mind. So I think 1 year, if somebody is going and taking risk, that is good enough. Otherwise, after 1 year, if he or she does not succeed, there are many jobs in hand for chartered accountant in which he can manage time. Like he can study for 4 to 6 hours and also keep on having some job. But even after that, if he does not if it does not qualify for the exam after, say, after 3 to 4 years, so that becomes a very big challenge mentally. So that has to build a lot of smartness, because you need to be ready for the failure. This exam is so tricky that there is a possibility you might not even clear in all the 6 attempts. There is always a probability for this. So you need to be very ready for that. You need to keep working on your backup options. Like, you need to crack alternate exams like Reserve Bank or ONGC or any other PSU. Or you can start practice of your own. You can be a part-time full-time partner in any firm. Or you can just keep yourself engaged in such a way that you don't become economically bankrupt at the end of these 4 or 5 years. So 1 year, 2 year is fine. Without job, you can take the plunge. But after that, you need to be completely sorted with your ideas. You need to have your backup in your hand. You need to be mentally prepared for whatever happens. You have to admit it. And this has been the way for many of us. I have seen people who joined Reserve Bank after having spent 4 or 5 years in UPSC preparation. They recommend the fact that after 1 or 2 years, one need to actually take up any job and also keep on preparing for UPSC. So that has to be the way going forward. And one just cannot be in Delhi for all 6 years preparing just UPSC, because that will leave you with no alternative after 6 years.
Yes, correct. So that's a very practical, pragmatic thing. So Saurav, you got All India rank 3 in the interview and overall rank 113. So your interview must have been like some super interview, that it amongst so many UPSC top-notch guys, you came All India 3rd. So tell us more about that interview preparation part, or how was that actual D-Day of that interview?
Sir, if I talk about my preparation part, normally I speak very fast. Okay, so that hindrance was always there according to me. But I went to one sir, Jyotirmay Paul Chaudhary. He lives in Salt Lake only. He prepares students for civil services. So what he told, that first, because at age of 32, you cannot change your basic style of speaking or basic speed of speaking. And at the same time, you sound very honest while you speak fast. So if you try to modulate the speed, you will sound a lot more artificial. So that was one suggestion which actually changed my mindset. I did not focus on my speed. I was more concerned about the way I present my ideas, my thought process. I am answering to the panel members. So these all became my focus areas instead of my speed or any other petty issues. So that, sir, played a very important role in my preparation. At the same time, there was one mantra for interview I just kept in mind. It was the fact that hona hai eventually ki aadhi ghanta 6 log aapse baat karenge. This is what is going to happen. Nothing more than that. Wo aadhi ghanta baat hi karna hai, and you need to impress with your words. Itna hi hona hai. Just because of the fact ki wo UPSC interview hai, we take it on our mind and we try to overdo it. Wo bilkul bhi maine nahi kiya. So one of the things I'll tell you ki all during my UPSC ka interview preparation, I played cricket for 3 hours daily, because I was not much bothered about it. It was not that I was not sincere about interview. I was not bothered about interview. I did my basics right. I revised some of the concepts of commerce. I tried to do personal mocks in front of mirror. I attended search classes on weekends. And then I was also focusing a lot on current affairs. I was trying to be apolitical. I was trying to be whatever UPSC expects. I was trying to be that. So that way I was doing my every bit. And after the fact that I was doing everything, I did not bother about as to what will happen. But sir, D-Day actually brings some sort of nerves into your mind. And when I went to UPSC interview, I was the first to be interviewed. So that created some sort of tension within my mind, that I was not expecting that I will be the first to go. But once I entered into the room for interview, the chairman sir complimented me with my academic accomplishments and work experience, and told that I could really manage really well to be here in front of UPSC panelists by continuously studying and working and not taking any leave for UPSC preparation. So this was the compliment which settled my nerves. And after that, it was more about Reserve Bank, commerce, some questions regarding Jharkhand and West Bengal, then they try to trick me with questions like IS1 ke kya karna hai, because we cannot be conventional about these answers. We need to speak ground realities while we talk about any such questions. Supreme Court ke bare mein, when they ask, then they were asking about Forest Rights Act. So my only idea was to speak for as a common person as to what a normal villager, a normal person in the town will think of. Yes, it was not academic. My answers were completely from the perspective of a normal person, and there was very less element of academics in those answers. I was not trying to show or flaunt my mains preparation there. I was talking as an individual in capacity of a citizen, and that is what was leading to further questions, which were very introspective, and I just kept on saying what was there in my mind with a lot of composure. Or wo initial 15 minutes ke baad, it became such easy conversation that I just went with the flow. The interview was of 40 minutes, and RBI luckily took 10 minutes of it, because RBI was a very hot topic in that time. There was a lot happening with RBI. But apart from that, it was more conversational in nature. India में समस्या क्या है, फॉरेस्ट राइट्स एक्ट में समस्या क्या है, सुप्रीम कोर्ट में केस पेंडिंग है तो क्यों है, एंड ऑल माय आंसर्स वेयर फ्रॉम एन इंडिविजुअल पर्सपेक्टिव एंड नॉट फ्रॉम एनी बुक और एनी अदर डॉक्यूमेंट. एंड लकीली फॉर मी, माय इंटरव्यू एंडेड विद अ नोट अबाउट माय पोएट्री. आई एम फॉन्ड ऑफ राइट कंपोजिंग पोइम्स, सो वन ऑफ द मेंबर्स टोल्ड मी टू रिसाइट वन ऑफ द पोइम्स. शी गॉट वेरी हैप्पी विद वन एंड शी टोल्ड मी टू recite another one. So that actually added to my confidence, and I just did that. So after those two poems, I was feeling very confident ki main interview acha ho gaya hai. But even after all this, I did not expect ki I'll be getting such good marks. So again, it was a very pleasant surprise, and it actually took my rank very high in the ladder. So interview played a very important role in my UPSC journey.
Yes. So I think it's a dream interview. I can relate to such things that once an interview, the panelist takes an extra effort to make you feel comfortable in the initial part. Then the rest of it can often become a breeze. As has happened also with one of my mock interviews at IIM Ahmedabad, which eventually became quite viral on YouTube with 1.5 million views plus.
Yes, sir, I had seen that interview.
Yes, so it was actually the other person, the panelist, who make you so comfortable that okay, you be your natural self and you start talking honestly, and they appreciate that. It kind of acts tremendously. Now, you've already, the question that I wanted to ask you was that on Quora, in your profile, you call yourself as a cricket enthusiast. So that you've already answered, that even during your interview days, you were playing 3 hours a day. A poet at heart, that I mean, in your interviews, you recited 2 poems. And then a lesser fool who is aware of his ignorance. Now, this is quite interesting. What is this, Saurav? A lesser fool who is aware of his ignorance?
Sir, maybe it is just one of the ways to keep myself humble. Sir, when I did CA, I could have felt that I am now full of myself. I have done enough in life. But again, there was certain avenue which was there in pipeline. So MBA came up, then RBI, UPSC. So the moment we do something and we become so full of ourselves that we have done enough, I think that is the end of the journey. So this is one of those attempts to keep myself humble and grounded, so that if there is any further avenue of learning, of any change in my life, I would be very much willing and acceptable and receptive to take it up. So ignorance is there in each of us. Whatever we have learned from society, that is, I believe, is purely conditioning, and we just feel proud of it. So I try to keep shedding this attitude and try to be what time makes me of. So I just try to be the one who is the object and not the subject. So that is what propelled me to write that statement about myself, that I just tried, because each of us is a fool, I am trying to be a lesser one. That's it.
All right. So the final question, now what are your aspirations? You start your training in 4 days. In a couple of years, you're going to become a district collector in Jharkhand, one of the districts. And I know for a fact that you will not stop. You might as well after your stint, you have an option to go abroad also for some studies, right?
Yes, that is there, sir.
So what are your plans? So, I mean, on the text, you're going to take it as it comes?
So Sir, as of now, academically, I don't have any plans because now since I've been able to crack this exam, I want to, so there were certain commitments which I made during my interview that this would be the way I will try to operate in a certain district if I'm given the charge. So those words were not the ones which I told to just impress the interviewers. It was more of my mindset, more of my thought process. Sir, being in a small town, Dumka is just a small town, it is not even a village. Whenever I have gone to nearby villages, I have seen the real challenges, which is becoming very tough to breach. I know that one individual cannot do many things, but in whatever capacity I can be of use to the society or to the people around, I will try to make most of it. So once I get trained and once I join my district, sir, in any possible way, I don't know the profile. Since I've not been on the ground till now, but in whatever capacity I will be required to serve, sir, I will do my best. So this is my mindset as of now. And academic wala thing, as in when it comes, maybe 10 years, 12 years, I don't know when it comes in mind. But for the next few years, I see myself doing what is required of an IAS officer, and that is what I'm focusing on right now.
And I've had the privilege also of teaching your wife, Parul, accountant.
I know, she's all admiration.
So how is she now? I mean, she must be flaunting IAS officer ki patni, and she would have been very happy now.
Sir, she's happy, but I'm lucky that she's not flaunting. She's very much under covers. She feels that it has been a long journey. She accepts the fact, but also a sense of humility I see in her eyes, and which really makes me very comfortable. I'm the one who have always been in the background, and I'm lucky to have somebody in my life who behaves the same way. Had it been flaunt, I would have become really, really uncomfortable. So that way, I feel really privileged and lucky to have her.
Wow. So thank you, Saurav, for sparing time out. So there's been construction activity going on around your vicinity. You're just supposed to join the training. Still, you took time out.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Saurav. So, any final thoughts that you want to give to the people who are watching that podcast?
So, the only thing I believe that it has to be completely for yourself if you are doing anything, be it academics, be it sports, or be it anything in life. Even on personal level, if you are having some difficulties, be it financially or emotionally, it has to be completely you who can rescue. Other people will be driven for positivity because they will borrow the idea for you from you. They will not have any idea about you till they don't get any hint from you. So it has to be you in the center, and people will only be periphery to your upbringing, to your making, to your support, to your criticism, or to your anything. So you need to feel that you own yourself, and that will actually help you in a very big way. So just keep building confidence, and time will take care of everything. So you need to be humble, and also you need to be confident. And I believe this is a very tough combination to have. So that way we can really gel in our lives.
Wow, those are some powerful words. You know, humility plus competence. We live in a world where it's more shallowness, and people tend to portray more than what they actually have. And the likes of Facebook have further accentuated that kind of a feeling. And here is Saurav, who comes across as a completely humble person with all his achievements, CA and then FMS, RBI, and now UPSC. So wonderful having you on the show, Saurav. I'm sure that the audience who also listen to this podcast are going to really love this. Thank you so much for being on the show. It's been a real pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir.
All right. Thank you. Bye bye. And all the best for your training, Saurav.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Yeah, bye.